So in this video lecture, we'll be starting with the new topic of tunneling. Let us start with the tunnel profiles. So tunnel profiles means what is the shape of the tunnel. There are various types of tunnel profiles. First of all them is circular tunnel. This type of tunnel is generally used to convey water in some part of the world. Such tunnels are also used for waterway transportation. So generally these circular tunnels are used for transporting water from from a dam to some other places where it is required, or most of the times they are also transported from the dam to the turbines where the electricity is generated. Such tunnels are called as head race tunnels. Head race tunnels. This word head comes because these tunnels are responsible for providing the required head for the turbines to spin, and then the electricity can be generated. And you can see here as well, they are also used for transportation purpose in some countries. Next tunnel profile is horseshoe shaped tunnel. As you can see, this shape is like a horseshoe, if you have seen. And the second one is arch with vertical walls. So this is an arch and it has got nearly vertical walls here. So this is another tunnel profile. Now let us talk about the excavation methods, because finally you will be excavating the tunnel through a mountain or through some series of rocks or some terrain features like folds or all those features. From that you will have to excavate our tunnel, and there are several methods that are used for excavation depending upon what type of rock we encounter and which method is going to be the most economical as well as the safest one. So the first method is full face method. As the name suggests, full face means that we are going to excavate the entire face of the tunnel at once. For example, if I talk about the horseshoe shape type, okay, let us say that this is the tunnel profile, horseshoe shape. The face of the tunnel means the entire, this entire profile is the face of the tunnel. You have got excavation methods through which either you can completely excavate the entire face at a go, means in one go, or you can do it partly. That is, either you can do the top portion first, then you can do the bottom portion. So in parts also it can be done, or it can be done full as well. So this first method talks about that full face, and in this what we have is we have a vertical columns erected, and on vertical columns we have these sliding drills. So exactly what we do is we erect these two vertical columns, and suppose that this tunnel is not excavated here, and here we have these sliding drills. So we have some arrangement here through which we can drill holes, and this drill sliding drill can slide over this column. So while it goes up, it will start drilling hole everywhere, and in those holes we can put some explosives, and after the explosion you will get or this face would be excavated. So this method is selected for tunnels with size less than 3 meters. So if the tunnel is small, only then we go for this full face excavation. The excavation of entire profile is done together. Vertical columns are erected and large numbers of drills are mounted. Holes are drilled and explosives are fixed, which create numerous joints in the rocks, which is called as muck. So after those explosives are placed inside those holes, they burst, and then whatever you get, the debris, it is called as muck. To remove muck, tracks can be fitted and extended as the tunneling is carried on. This method is not suitable for unstable rocks. Now why? Because if the rocks are unstable and you excavate the entire part together, it may so happen that, for example, let us consider again this horseshoe shaped type of tunnel. Okay. And it is part of some rocks here. Okay, there are rocks all around, and this much portion I want to excavate for my tunnel purpose. If the rocks are unstable and if you excavate the entire portion together, what will happen? These rocks which are on top of the tunnel, they will lose their support entirely and the chances are that they might collapse inside. So that is why it is not suitable for unstable rocks. Second method is heading and benching method. So what we have in this is we can divide the face of the tunnel in two parts. First is the head part and the second is the bench part. Heading means that you excavate the top portion first. As you can see, we have excavated the top portion first and the bottom one is left, and whatever the debris here was there, it has come down. So from here it can be taken out. The same can also be seen in this image. Now when we see this image, it feels that it is such a small thing, you know, this much part is so small, but then you can see these two people here, and from that you can understand how huge this tunnel would be, and that is generally the size of tunnels. In this method, the heading or top or upper half of the tunnel is bored first and then the bench, that is bottom or lower half, follows. The heading portion lies about 3.7 to 4.6 meter ahead of the bench, that is this portion will be 3.7 to 4.6. Again, this method is more suitable for the hard rocks because we are excavating this top portion, and if the rocks above this are not hard, then it may so happen that they may collapse. In certain cases, when the rocks are not hard, you have to provide a temporary lining inside. This cementitious thing, you can see, this is called as a lining, the lining of a tunnel. So if I'm excavating a profile like this, inside I have to give us a very thin thin layer of concrete. That layer of concrete, without finishing, that is after definitely. Now this is only done for the purpose of supporting the top rock, which is on this, because the top rock is going to put some load on the tunnel, right? So to support that top rock, we have to provide some lining from inside, and it is like just at the beginning stage, and as we proceed ahead, as we progress ahead, the final lining will also come on top of this. So this will be the final lining, which is much finished, and this is the lining that you would be seeing when you move inside from the tunnel after it has finished completely. So for the finishing part, this final lining comes. The advantage that we get in this method is that we can place the explosives in the benching while we are taking out the muck. So this muck that is produced due to heading, when we are taking it out, at the same time we can also put the explosives in the benching part, and then we can proceed ahead for the explosion of that bench. So that much time is also saved. Next method is called as drift method. So this small part that you can see, itself is like a small tunnel. The actual profile of the tunnel is this big one, but then we drill a small tunnel or small hole through it. It is called as drift. And in this image also, you can see that the entire profile is not excavated, but first a small part here is excavated, then a small part on the right side is excavated. So based on the location, we can identify drift as a bottom drift, that is if it is at the bottom one. A top drift, it is if it is done at the top of the tunnel profile. A center drift and two side drifts, which we just saw in the previous image. So what could be advantage of this drift method? The first advantage would be that since we are drilling a small tunnel first before actually going for the entire profile, that small tunnel we may excavate to either the full length of the tunnel or to partial length of the tunnel, and while we are excavating that small part, we can come to know that what is the rock quality that we will be encountering later on, whether it has a water content to it or it is weak or is it strong, and based on that we can take the corrective measures which would be required when we actually go on for the full excavation of the profile. Right, that is one of the major advantages. Second is this small tunnel, small drift is going to provide ventilation to the entire part. Now that ventilation is so important, I used to work in a company, Gammon India, and I was employed on a tunnel in Himachal Pradesh for some part of the time. And during this, you won't believe that the amount of dust that is generated when the explosives are exploded, and then when the muck is generated there, the amount of dust is very dangerous and lethal to human lungs. So the ventilation of the tunnel is very, very important part. And generally, if we cannot provide a ventilation like this, we do provide, for example, I'll just try to draw a tunnel here. Let us say that this is a part of the tunnel. Okay. Let us say that the tunnel is something like this. So inside the tunnel, we provide pipelines which carry air. Okay, we have to provide these pipelines which carry air so that we can give oxygen to our laborers or workers who are deep inside the tunnel. Some pipes are there also to carry the water so that the muck can be converted into slurry, and it is easier for transportation. Such things happen in the actual drift in the actual excavation of tunnel. So it is a very challenging job for civil engineers. The disadvantage of this method would be that you will have to first of all complete the excavation of the drift. So till that time you cannot complete the excavation of your entire profile. So that much time is wasted, that you complete the drift excavation first and then you go on for the entire excavation. So that time is wasted in this. So yeah, the drift is a small tunnel driven completely or partially. Usually its size is 3 meters by 3 meters. The drift may be provided at center, sides, bottom or top as desired, as it is seen here. In this method, after driving the drift, the drill holes are drilled all around the drift in the entire cross section of the tunnel, filled with explosives and ignited. So after you after you excavate the drift, then you can drill the explosives here like this, so that you further excavate the part, the entire part of the tunnel profile. And these advantages are pretty much what I just discussed, advantages and disadvantages. One disadvantage that I did not discuss is the cost of drilling and removing the muck from the drift is high, as the work has to be done using manually operated power driven equipment. So since this tunnel is actually very small, it is not feasible for humans to go there because the working conditions would not be very good. Even though the 3 meter by 3 meter is quite huge, but lesser the human contact, that much is better. So this was it for today's lecture. In the next lecture, we'll be learning some more excavation methods and some other topics in tunneling. Till then, take care. Thank you.